One of the very best things about photography is the ability to be able to take pictures of the people that we love, to be able to take pictures of ourselves, the places that we've been, to record our stories, and to be able to take pictures of our friends and the people that we meet who will be with us for the rest of our lives through these memories, through these photographs that we have taken. What's brilliant about smartphones is that it's never been easier to take these photographs, to record these memories. But taking pictures of ourselves and taking pictures of other people, it is not easy. You know, it does require skill, it requires patience, and it does require a good eye. I want to help you take the best possible portraits that you can, so that when you look back on these photographs in the future, that you will be filled with joy and nostalgia. So welcome to lesson number 6. We're going to talk all about portraits and, of course, selfies as well. I'm going to talk about capturing our uniqueness. And simply put, portrait photography is very important. We are very diverse. We are all different. We all have our own nuances. We all have our own stories, our own characteristics. And as photographers, when we take a portrait, we should be aiming to capture something a little bit deeper than what's on the surface. We can have a lot of fun with our portrait photography, of course, and it should be primarily about creating memories. But we can do so much more with it. We can show just how diverse we all are, but remembering that we are all part of one race, and that is the human race. So good portrait photography should reveal a message. It should tell us something about the person in the photograph. And this could be a person that we aspire to be like, which is something that we experience every single day through the use of beauty and fashion photography. When, you know, companies, they hire celebrities, they hire models to essentially influence us and to promote a product or a lifestyle, something that we think that we need, that's going to make our lives better and to add to our character. Like, for example, this photograph of Eva Green here by Dior. I mean, it really doesn't tell us much about Eva Green, but obviously there's definitely an air of something mysterious and almost something dangerous, you know, within this photograph. And perhaps that's something that, you know, you want to be part of your character. So you might go out and you might buy this perfume. And I mean, that's how portrait photography is used within advertising. We look at it, we want to be like that person in the photograph, so we go and buy the product. So it can be used in a way to influence us, and that can be a positive thing and that can be a negative thing as well. Good portrait photography should reveal someone's character. It'll capture someone's character or essence, and again, this can be positive or negative. So here's a very famous photograph of Marilyn Monroe from probably the best portrait photographer to ever live, Richard Avedon. And this is you know, quite a moment of perhaps introspection of something that we normally wouldn't associate Marilyn Monroe with, you know, obviously famous for her the blonde bombshell kind of persona. But it is exactly that. It was a persona that she created, that Norma Mortensen created. When I look at this photograph, what I think is happening here is that she's actually beginning to get into character, that she's ready to become Marilyn Monroe. So it's just this absolute split second of portraiture perfection. And good portrait photography will also inform the viewer. We've looked at this photograph before, the migrant mother from Dorothea Lange. And this was part of a series that was commissioned by the Pharma Security Administration, the FSA, in the USA during the 20s and the 30s. They hired a whole heap of incredibly famous photographers to go out and document what was happening in America at the time. And you know, this photograph came to represent the Great Depression, the struggles that people were going through at the time, all through this single photograph. And I mean, you should check out the FSA's work. There's a huge amount of photography history involved with them. And documenting culture is another part of our portrait photography. Again, incredibly famous photograph here of the Afghan girl, taken by Steve McCurry. And this is again a culture that was disappearing, was changing. And again, as part of our role as photographers, when we take a photograph, we may not even realize it, but sometimes we can be photographing something that is on the cusp of disappearing and may never be seen again. And finally, portrait photography, as I've mentioned earlier, the most important thing is to preserve memories, is to preserve our own memories. Our children growing up, that only happens once. You know, your firstborn child, that only happens once. The first time they go to school, and you know, the first time that they graduate, all of these kind of things, they'll only ever happen once, but those memories will last as long as we do through portrait photography. So with all of that in mind, let's get into our first topic, probably the most important topic, the first consideration when it comes to taking anyone's photograph is lighting. Now there are some common terms, of course, to go through before we dig into this lesson. We're going to talk about lighting types. We're going to talk about metering. We had a look at how to do better exposures in the previous lesson. We're going to combine that now with how we can read the light through different metering modes. We're going to talk about white balance, an important topic overall when it comes to our photographs, but particularly important when it comes to portrait photography to make sure that all our skin tones are correct. We'll have a brief look at flash. We're going to dig into that a lot more in the next lesson. We're also going to talk about bokeh. So that's one I get asked a lot about. We'll have a look at how you can achieve that with your portrait photography. And then we'll have a look at selfies and self-portraits, and there is a difference between the two of them. So the first thing then is lighting. And there's two primary ways to light a subject. Now there's lots of different lighting styles and techniques that we can use. But there's two primary ways to consider lighting our subject before we take the photograph. And one is called key lighting, which is where we very specifically highlight the subject through how we use the light that's available to us, or if we're using artificial light, and it highlights the subject. It very much draws the viewer's attention onto our subject. Then we also have fill lighting. So fill lighting is a more even and balanced lighting. It'll help the subject, and you know, particularly if you're photographing them in an environment where the rest of the environment is also important as well. So key lighting and fill lighting are the two primary ways to consider lighting our subject. Now, with that in mind, we can use our different metering modes to achieve key lighting and to achieve fill lighting. And metering modes simply change how we can read the light using our phones and using our cameras. There's a variety of metering modes available to us, but there's three fundamental ones that we're going to have a look at. And for those of you who are using DSLRs or mirrorless cameras, you can actually download apps that will turn your phone into an incident light meter, which basically means that it's a reading a light directly falling onto your subject. So it acts like an actual incident light meter as well. Okay, so let's have a look at how these different metering modes work. You'll find them in your pro mode. Again, I'm sure you've come across them now at this stage if you've been exploring your pro mode, these different metering modes available to you in your camera. So the three ones that we're going to be having a look at, because these are the ones that you should be using, there are probably more variations of these. We're going to have a look at what's known as matrix or evaluated metering, center weighted metering, and spot metering as well. These are the three primary metering modes available to us, beginning with our evaluative metering. Basically, this metering mode acts like a grid over our photographs that reads the light across the entire scene. So from every edge of the photograph all the way through the center, it's reading and assessing all of the light in the scene, and it creates this meter reading based on all of that information. And this is typically our default setting. Now, where this can be incredibly useful is when it comes to a photograph like this. It comes to a landscape photograph. So this is a scene where we want to read the entire light across all the scene. We've got a huge amount of information in the sky, in the foreground, to the left and the right parts of the photograph as well. And if we were to visualize how the camera is actually reading the light, it would look something like this. We have a grid. Each of the blocks here, the camera is measuring the light in that area, and it puts all this information then to give us our light meter reading. So that's essentially how our matrix, our evaluative metering works. And as I mentioned, it's typically our default setting. And for the majority of our day-to-day photographs, it is going to be perfectly fine to use. But there are going to be situations where we're going to need to change the metering mode. So the next one to have a look at it is known as a center weighted metering. So sometimes we're taking photographs, we don't really need to worry about the information on the very edges of the photograph because our subject is centralized, or we're pointing the camera, we're taking a portrait, for example, is the best way to visualize it. So if we do that, if we have a look at this subject here, here we've got a photograph. It's a backlit photograph. It also has really nice bokeh, as you can see there in the background. We'll speak about that a little bit later. But as we can see here, we've got a very strong backlight, particularly with the hair light on the subject. So if I was to take this photograph using the previous mode, the evaluated metering mode, likely the subject is going to be underexposed. So by using my center weighted metering, if I was to visualize it here again, we can see that it's taking its reading from the center part of the photograph really. So the subject is in the center, it's taking its light meter reading from the subject, so it's not worrying about the light in the background. Our exposure is being measured off the woman in the middle here, which is exactly what we want, because we want to make sure that she is exposed correctly. And it means we get a little bit of overexposure in the background. That's okay, because remember, primarily our subject is the lady in the center. So center weighted metering is a great option, a great mode for portrait photography. But there's a more accurate mode and a little bit more of a difficult one to use, and that's our spot metering. And spot metering only measures the light from a tiny part of the scene, only about 2-4% of the entire scene. This means it's very, very accurate. It's very simple to use spot metering on your camera. It's actually a lot more tricky to use it on something like a DSLR or a mirrorless camera. But on our phones, it's actually much easier, because we just simply touch onto the area that we want to read the light from using this. So let's have a look at an example of it. Here we've got a very tricky lighting scenario. If I was to use my matrix metering, that would be difficult here, because it's going to read all of the light in the rest of the scene here, all at the edges. As we can see, that's very, very dark. And we've got our subject against the window, very, very bright. The camera is not going to be able to read that dynamic range, and likely it's going to end up overexposing our model here, our bride, I think, here in the middle. I could use my center weighted metering here again, but again, it's still going to cover perhaps too large of an area, you know, where it's going to take in some of those darks when I don't want to. So what I really want to do here is I want to make sure that the model is exposed correctly. And as I've mentioned before, we should always be concentrating on the face. We should be taking our focus from the face. We can also take our meter reading from the face here as well. So by using spot metering, I can actually just focus on the face, and at the same time, I can read the light off the face. That's going to give me the correct exposure from the face. And then when I get the exposure correct for her face, it should give me the correct exposure for the entire scene. And as you can see here, it has. The results are very, very good. So only a tiny little bit of space here that spot metering reads the light from. So this mode wouldn't be particularly good for, say, doing landscape photographs, but it is great for very tricky scenarios like this, and particularly with key lighting. So I mentioned key lighting earlier on. This is an example of key lighting. We've got one light that's highlighting our subject and making her stand out from the background. Spot metering is an ideal mode for this. So that's our different metering modes. We'll park those for now, and we'll move on and we'll talk about white balance. So white balance is something, again, I'm sure you've come across it now at this stage if you've been exploring your phones. And white balance basically determines the color of our photographs. First of all, it's measured in kelvins, so if you're wondering what are these numbers with the K beside them, that's the actual color temperature. Each light source, different light sources, give off a different color temperature. Okay, and this can cause a color cast on our photographs. White balance will remove this color cast. So the idea is, if I have a photograph that's too blue, it's full of blue tones because of the light, the white balance will correct that to give me a neutral colors. Okay, it can also be used, however, creatively to add warmth or coolness to a photograph. So we can actually use it in a way that's creative to change the atmosphere or the mood or the look of a photograph. And it can be adjusted afterwards in editing if needs be. So if your phone gets it wrong, there's no need to panic. It is possible to correct later on as well. So let's have a quick look at it. So white balance is based on a Kelvin scale, which is something like this. It ranges from 1,000 up to about 10,000. And the lower the number, the warmer the colour is going to be. Okay, so for example, a candle flame, which we know would give off a very kind of warm glow, is going to be quite a low number compared to a clear blue sky. So it goes a little bit in the opposite way. You think something like a clear blue sky would have a colder colour temperature, but it's actually higher. Okay, so it's a higher Kelvin value. And these different lighting scenarios will cause casts on our photographs. And the idea is that white balance will help to correct that. Let's have a look at some examples of this. So white balance is very easy to use in the sense that we have lots of presets available to us. It is also possible to dial in custom Kelvin values if needs be as well. Auto white balance will generally do a very good job for us. The camera will set the white balance automatically. We have lots of different preset modes there if needs be, if the auto white balance gets it wrong. So say, for example, tungsten light, we'll have a look at it in a moment. It's a very tricky light. That's kind of our the light that we'd find in our lamps, you know, typically at home as well, produces a very warm cast. So to balance that off, if we select the tungsten balance, it'll add cool tones. So the white balance presets do the opposite. They balance out the light. Okay, so a cloudy day, again, will usually produce kind of a cool looking photograph, but the white balance will add warm tones to balance that out in an attempt to give us a neutral shot. Let's have a look at that. Let's visualize it. So first of all, with our auto white balance, so it's a default mode, the camera assesses the scene and will choose the correct Kelvin value based on that scene, but it can be inaccurate in mixed light scenes. Let's have a look at this photograph here of this gentleman. Shot in a studio like setting, as we can see, it's quite cool, it's quite cold. We can tell this because if we look at the white shirt, we can see that there's definitely kind of a blue hue, and the background as well is kind of a blue gray type of background, and his skin tones just look a little bit cool, look a little bit cold. Using the auto white balance will assess the scene, and now we can see we have a much more neutral photograph. What do I mean by neutral? I mean one where the greys are grey, the whites are whites, and the blacks are black. So the colours appear correct to us now using the auto white balance. Let's have a look at another example. Daylight is a term that actually has two meanings when we talk about it in a white balance scenario. It's an actual setting, a daylight balance setting in our scenes, but it also means neutral balance. So you may find that, say, for example, if you get to a stage where you're working in a studio, you can buy daylight balanced studio lights, and the idea is that they give you a neutral color, a neutral tone on the photograph. So if we have a look at this photograph, say for example, it's clearly shot in the shade. So the Kelvin value for daylight temperature is about 5,500 Kelvins, right in the middle, more or less. And this is typically what our phones are trying to achieve, and our cameras indeed, when they use the auto white balance, is to achieve a daylight kind of balance, a neutral balance. Again, if we have a look at this photograph, it's very clearly shot in the shade because you can see we've got a kind of cool look to the photo. Now, we could use our shade white balance preset to add a warm tone to it. But if we were to use a daylight balance, approximately a daylight balance, we can see here it gives us also a very accurate result. So the skin tones look correct to us now, and it's not until sometimes after you've seen the change that you realise just how much of a difference is made. Just a final one then to have a look at in terms of white balance is tungsten light. So tungsten light is our artificial light, the type of light that we'd find at home in general. And it produces a very kind of warm yellowy tone. And it's very problematic for skin tones, a heavy yellow cast. As we can see here, you know, if we have a look at this lady's top, you know, it should be white, but we can see there's a bit of a cast over the color of it. Choosing tungsten light will actually produce a strong blue hue in the image, and that balances out the yellow nicely. So for us to use it here, we can see that it has balanced it out and that the skin tones are more accurate. It's still not perfect, but it's a lot better than it was. And as we can see now, even if we have a look at the top again, that it has that kind of white color back in it now. So with this in mind, we can actually use these different presets though in a creative way to influence and change the mood of a photograph. So for example, in a shot like this, we could set it purposely to the tungsten white balance setting to give it that kind of blue colder image, that blue kind of cold look in it. Or we could go and a photograph like this, we could add a shade setting to it to increase the kind of warmth of it there as well. So, you know, we can get creative with it. And as I said, it is also possible to do this afterwards as well, which we certainly will have a look at how to do that in upcoming lessons. Finally then, just on the subject of lighting, as you can see, it's taken a good portion of the lesson, but it is very important. We also, of course, have our flash. Now, we're going to talk about flash a lot more in our low light photography lesson, our next lesson. It is limited due to phone size, so most of the time when we use a flash, it gives us disappointing results, and a lot of it is down to the actual size of the flash itself. But the camera will basically assess how much light is needed, and will change the brightness of the flash depending on, you know, how far away the subject is and how much light is needed. Now, there is only a certain distance that the flash will be able to go as well, again, because it's limited due to the size of the phone. But where we can get effective with flash is to balance it with ambient light. And we can control the ambient light by using the shutter speed. So what I mean by ambient light is the light that's available to us already, the light in the background. Shutter speed will control that ambient light, so we can make it brighter or darker, and it has no impact on the flash. And this is something that we're going to have a look at deeper in the next lesson. We can actually get quite creative with flash when we know how to balance it using shutter speed. Now, so we'll leave that there for now. And did you know that Robert Cornelius was credited with the first ever selfie? Robert Cornelius, all the way back in 1839. So it wasn't invented by Kim Kardashian. It wasn't invented by Paris Hilton. I think Paul McCartney claimed he invented it at some stage as well. So lots of people seem to have tried to claim the idea of the selfie, but the oldest recorded version is Robert Cornelius's one back in 1839, which of course was the year that photography was officially invented as well. So it didn't really take long for people to decide to start photographing themselves when photography came about. Now, I mean, it's the oldest recorded one. It doesn't necessarily mean it was the first, but historically it is documented as the very first one taken in 1839. The first light picture, 1839, Robert Cornelius. Now, so moving on from that into our second topic, we're moving away from the kind of technical stuff for now. We'll have a look at composition for portraits. And we've established a lot of this now already in previous lessons, because first of all, just a quick review on depth of field. We spoke about how you can achieve depth of field through the aperture. We can't change the aperture on the most of our smartphones, the majority of them. But we can get closer if we change the focal length. So if we were to use a portrait lens or a zoom lens attachment, like we looked at back in all the way in lesson number 2, you can reduce the camera to subject distance to increase that depth of field where, you know, if you are doing a portrait, we should be trying to get a little bit closer anyway. And we also consider the subject to background distance as well. So if you want to increase that depth of field effect, you know, you don't want to have someone standing up against the wall. You want to try and have a nice wide open space behind them that will give you that depth of field effect. So just to review very quickly, you know, we saw this, that when we're closer to our subject, that the depth of field is shallower. But as they move further away from the camera, that depth of field area is going to become much deeper and much wider. So bear that in mind when you're trying to get that depth of field effect. Now, Remember as well that if we're taking our focus from the eyes, when we're photographing, focusing on the eyes, that this is where our plane of focus is going to begin. So we can achieve that shallow depth of field effect by getting a little bit closer, focusing on the eyes. That produces our plane of focus, and shallow depth, our depth of field will extend from that point too. So tips to achieve depth of field, as I've mentioned, get closer, zoom in using optical zoom if it's an option that's available to you. You can use those telephoto lens attachments as well, or a portrait lens attachment. Change where you focus, focus on the eyes, and move your subject away from the background. All of these factors together will help you to achieve a shallow depth of field, which is typically, but not always, what we're trying to achieve when we do a portrait photograph. And we're going to have a look at apps that can recreate that depth of field effect as well. So if you are struggling with it, there's probably an app for it, and that's what we're going to learn in upcoming lessons, that with all of these things that we've looked at throughout this course so far, there's probably an app for it, and that includes fully manual mode too. But all of that in due time. Now, one of the things that also is an effect of a shallow depth of field is what's called bokeh. Bokeh. What is bokeh? And it's certainly present in this photograph. And students, sometimes when they first join this course or my other photography course, they get confused about depth of field and bokeh, thinking that they're the same thing. And bokeh is something that's produced after depth of field. So first of all, it's pronounced bokeh. B-O, bokeh. Not bokey, not bokeh, it's bokeh. Okay, so have no arguments about it. It's bokeh. So bokeh basically is the out of focus light in the photograph. It's the shape of the out of focus light in the photograph. We can see it evident here in this shot. We've got some foreground bokeh. I don't know if that's an effect that's been added afterwards or if it's true holding the fairy lights that this lady is holding, but we can certainly see it here in the background as well in the lights of the city. Okay, so that's a very good example of it, and it's the out of focus light, that shape, that kind of circular light. It's not always circular, it can be kind of hexagonal as well. That is known as bokeh. Now, bokeh is something that can be tricky enough to achieve, and close focus on the subject will help to increase that depth of field effect, as I've said ad nauseum now at this stage. But the closer to the subject you are is going to help to create that shallow depth of field. And again, think about your background. You need to have a nice fall off in the background so that there's enough room for that depth of field to fall off. Different lens attachments will produce different bokeh shapes. So, you know, those lens attachments we spoke about in previous lessons, lesson number 2. Our portrait lenses, our telephoto lenses, they might produce slightly different bokeh shapes, like more circular ones, more kind of hexagonal type of shapes, and try different light sources. So we don't need to just look at using kind of city lights in the background. Bokeh is something that can also be achieved, you know, during the daytime. So if you think about, if you're doing a portrait of somebody, think about having light coming through the trees in the background. So if you're photographing them in a forest, in a park, anywhere with lots a light coming through the trees, you can produce really nice bokeh effect using that as a background light. Now, we won't be speaking about posing your subject in this lesson. There would be a whole lesson itself in that. There's lots of great guides online, on Pinterest in particular, on how to pose your subject. But what is important is where to crop on portraits. Okay, so when you're cropping on portraits, do crop above any joints. Try out many different poses and remember the rule of thirds. And indeed, remember all of the other compositional rules and techniques we had a look at back in lesson 3. And central compositions work great, so do try them out as well when it comes to portrait photography. Fill your frame, or, you know, decide whether or not you want to give your subject a little bit of room. Now, what you don't want to do is crop through joints. That's the major no-no really when it comes to portrait photography. You don't want to be cropping through knees, through elbows, through necks, etc., because it just doesn't look correct. It looks like you're kind of cutting off a part of the person. So always try to crop above or below joints. Let's have a look at what I mean by that. So, with our typical standard composition, we've kind of got a head and shoulder shot. This looks correct to us. We're not cropping through any joints, not cropping through the neck, not cropping off the top of the head. We can zoom out a little bit more and we've got an upper body portrait. So we're maybe just losing a little bit over there on the right side, but it still looks correct to us. We're not cropping through joints. We're not cutting off through the elbow here. I know we're losing a little bit at the bottom there, but it still looks right to us because I'm not cropping through it. I'm just cropping just below it. Zoom out a little bit more. We've got our three-quarter length portrait, just a crop above the knees. Zooming out again, below the knees would be our next one. And as you can see, each one of these looks correct to our eyes, no matter which one you decide to pick, because we're cropping in the right place. And finally then, we have our full-length portrait. Our full length shot here, and a nice pose to go along with that there as well. So because we cropped correctly on this image, no matter which one of these portraits we were to choose, they all look right. And that's just from a single photograph. That's just one photograph we're cropping at different parts of the image. Now, so let's have a quick look at what we're going to be covering in the next lesson. So we're going to be all about low light and nighttime photography in the next lesson. We're going to have a look at things like our eyes. So finally, we'll have a look at our flash photography. We'll have a look at how you can do long exposures as well, capture light trails, do a bit of light painting, and how you can also photograph things like fireworks and the night sky. So it's a really cool, interesting lesson. Can get some really terrific photographs at night when you know how to do it correctly. Now finally, moving on into our last topic, let's talk all about ourselves. Let's have a look at selfies. Now, first of all, there is a definition here to just clarify. There's a difference between selfies and a self-portrait. Selfies tend to be a lot more informal. They're something that we would take nearly, every day. They're something that we share online. Basically, if we were wearing a nice outfit or we're just feeling good about ourselves and we want a little bit of, a little bit of positive reinforcement in that, we might put something online. And obviously, like someone like Kim Kardashian, posting, 10 or 12 selfies a day. I'm not really sure how many she would publish. Published 2 books on selfies. She's taken that many photographs of herself. But that's different from taking a self-portrait. Self-portrait is something where there's a lot more thought behind it. It's something more deeper. It's something that we take. Maybe we're trying to explore something more about our personalities. Maybe we're going through a difficult time. We want to use photography in a way that's kind of therapeutic. Maybe we're struggling to understand ourselves, understand our identities, and we're using self-portraiture as a way to explore our identity and figure out who we are. Or perhaps there's something going on in the world that we want to comment on, that we want to be a part of, that we want to bring awareness to. We can also use ourselves as a way to do this, like in this photograph here by Elena Broadhurst. So she was very much influenced by painting. This is a recreation of a famous painting known as Der Wanderer. But she's taken art history here as a source of inspiration for self-portraiture. And indeed, looking at art and the history of portraiture of art is something that can give you great ideas and what to do with your own portraiture too. But let's have a look at some tips for selfies. First of all, if you ever come across a selfie like this, it isn't real. I see so many of these types of photographs, particularly stock types of images and that as well, and people come to me and they're like, I want to take a selfie that's this high quality. It's not a selfie. This is taken by a professional photographer. This is someone just reaching out to the lens of a professional camera. They haven't taken the photograph themselves. Okay, so these types of images, these are not really selfies. And you see so many of these types of photographs out there, but they're actually done by professional photographers who are saying, give me that selfie recreation effect, put your hand out towards the lens and reach for it. But don't be fooled, this isn't a selfie. But when it comes to selfies though, just a couple of tips here. Think about your backgrounds primarily. So when you're photographing, if you're photographing yourself in a really nice environment, think about what you're putting behind yourself. And remember, you can get yourself a nice bit of depth of field as well, depending on where you place that background. So think about what's going on in your background. You don't want to have it overwhelming you at the same time as well, because primarily, remember, this is a photograph about yourself. So you're still the subject in the shot. So make sure that your backgrounds don't overwhelm you in the photograph. Think about your lighting as well. Obviously, the first thing we spoke about in this lesson. So if you're photographing, say you're stuck indoors, like we all are at the moment, you can photograph yourself against a window. So use that window light as a key light. You know, at different times during the day, that light's going to change. Think about that direction of the light that it's coming from. At the same time, you don't want to be looking directly into that light, or else you're just going to end up with a photograph where you're squinting. So maybe just angle yourself a little bit away from it. Also think about your framing as well. So again, thinking about your background, but think about how you might use your background to frame yourself, you know, to create a natural frame, like in this image here. The person taking a selfie has used the bridge in the background as kind of a framing device. Think about that too, you know, even if it's just something as simple as a doorway or a window frame, to frame yourself, to give a frame within a frame. Avoid cliches. We've all seen this photograph 100 million times before. So try to do something a little bit different when you're photographing yourself. Natural photographs, natural selfies, they're going to age a lot better. You're going to look back on those a lot more fondly than if you're doing something like this, you know, kind of creating a silly face. Why these are kind of good for a little bit of fun. You know, these are not the kind of ones I think that we want to be looking back on as we get older. Think about your angles as well. So when I'm talking about angles, do take lots of photographs of yourself. Take loads of pictures of yourself, because you're going to learn what's your best angle. You're going to learn what way you look best when taking a photograph. And this will also help you to take better pictures of other people when you understand what angles work best for them. So you might try an angle that works on you, and you might find that it works really well on someone else. Maybe it doesn't, but maybe another angle will. And also, when I speak about angles, think about the angle that you photograph yourself from as well. So not just the way you move your head in the shot, but whether you're photographing high or low, whether you're photographing from left or right, you know, mix it all up. You could spend an entire day just photographing yourself using different head angles and using different angles of the lens as well. And with that in mind, you can also remember to use your delayed timer. There's no reason why we have to do a selfie where we're actually using a selfie stick or we're holding the camera. If you've got yourself a little tripod, you've got yourself a delayed timer, you know, put it on 10 seconds, put yourself into the photograph, and you can take a full length portrait. You can put yourself into the environment, and you can get a completely different type of selfie when you put yourself into the shot in a full-length portrait without having to reach out and hold the camera. And finally then, just to bring it back to the kind of cliches, and that don't overdo it. No one really wants to look at these kind of duck faces or these other types of trends, and that they look silly. They get tiresome, and as I said, they're probably not going to age very well. Of course, photography goes through trends, and we see lots of people trying the same thing at the same time, and maybe next year it's going to be something different as well. But this just looks a little bit ridiculous. So I'm sorry if you've taken a photograph like this before, but try to avoid doing this. Try to avoid going over the top, unless you're doing it on purpose, unless there's a you're purposely over exaggerating the photograph. I would generally try to stay away from doing this in a shot. Maybe there is some people out there that do want to see a picture of me doing a duck face, but it is not going to happen. Now, so let's have a look at what's coming up in the next lesson. So as I mentioned earlier, we're going to have a look at low light and nighttime photography. We're going to have a look at how to do long exposures. We'll talk all about ISO, and we'll have a look at how to use our flashes correctly. So a really great lesson, and you'll really get some cool photographs after this lesson too. So
please subscribe, like, and share.